Actually, I now work at Cambridge University Test and Assessment, because it's changed. But first of all, I want to thank the organisers for inviting me here. I'm pleased to be able to talk. I've learned quite a few things. I'm not going to talk for very long, but I hope you'll learn a few new things, even not very useful. I'm basically an editor, and it's part of my job, essentially, to spot opportunities. To spot opportunities, to listen to authors, to interact with content providers more generally, to nurture their ideas, if they make sense to me, into products that I think will be sufficiently valuable for readers that they'll fork out money for them, or that at least someone will pay for at the point of delivery. The title of this programme is Communicating Mathematics for the Public. I'm assuming that the people who do the communication are typically mathematical scientists. And the mathematical scientists, I looked that up on Google yesterday, and it says, according to the US Bureau of Labor Statistics, mathematicians and statisticians analyze data and apply computational techniques to solve problems. So they're basically users rather than teachers or creators. But nevertheless, I think that's too narrow a definition. I think that all these things, animals, make up the species of mathematical scientists, and just like other species, they need to survive and they need to maintain their population and to live in a healthy and environment. So, they're basically going to communicate their one of the ways they can survive is to teach. One of the ways they can survive is to show their value to users. And the users themselves could be basically the public, by other learners, or it could be an old friend. I had a UK article in there. And then there these mysterious people that someone referred to as the general reader who doesn't exist. You probably can't read that. But as my granddaughter aged 8, reading Calculus by Martin Klein, I think it is. Anyway, and she loved all the tricky numbers, which is why she was reading it. But anyway, that's really, the mathematical scientists, big area, all sorts of people, and the public is too big as well. So, since this is mathematical, I'm going to use it for talk. And so one of my things is going to be big. It's too big for me to be able to produce something or publish something if I'm sort of trying to write for everybody, by everybody. I need to focus a little bit more. I could focus on learners, I could be publishing textbooks, or I could be publishing for these mysterious objects or general readers, or I could be focusing on some other sort of area, business, industry, and government, which accidentally also is an acronym for BIG. So that's going to be one of my things, I think, BIG. How do mathematicians or mathematical scientists really sort of communicate their value to some of these alien species? They can try to explain what mathematics is about. They can explain about mathematics. They could explain how to use or do mathematics. They could explain what the result of doing mathematics. Or they could actually do mathematics on behalf of a third party. And I can ramble on about all of these, and I have, in fact, in the past rambled on about all of them. But since Rob is going to be talking about mysterious ones and how to publish for them, I'm actually going to focus on business, industry, and government, because I think that that is an area where we can spot an opportunity. And that's an important part of business practices, to spot an opportunity. The opportunity, I think, is that most mathematicians, when they're publishing research, when they're publishing, they're either going to be writing sort of books which are generally aimed either at other academics or learners or the general public, or they're going to be publishing articles, which typically is research written by mathematicians for mathematicians, academic to academic. But I reckon there might, having listened to a lot of people and spoken to a lot of people, I thought there might be an opportunity to, for us to be able to publish mathematical research that's written by mathematicians but for business, industry and government. There isn't really a vehicle for them. The publisher provides certain services. Here are a few publishers, I hope. Here are a few publishers. You know all of them. Some offer different services. Some more conventional publishers. Some are more modern. Some believe in print and electronic. Some just believe in electronic. Some types of content are more suited to electronic. Some or short documents, articles. Some are more appropriate for longer. We heard that if you want to get your message across, I suppose, to the general most of the public, then really you need to write short. If you want to really to actively engage and learn how to keep stuff, you need to write books. But there are all articles. I think that's where the conventional publishers like Cambridge University Press or Taylor & Francis come to the fore, because what such publishers do is they provide a different sort of service, or they can do. They are not only recognising the opportunity, they're not only finding the authors, they're also curating the content, they're developing it, they're presenting it, or they're changing the presentation of it. They're working with the author and various other people to make sure that the author's message, the author's aim, is actually being presented in an optimal way for the reader to be able to understand what's going on and to get some deliverable from it. And deliverable is the appropriate word here, I think, because as I said right at the beginning, we are publishing stuff that we expect people to pay for. So we have to make sure that the author is not only going to understand that there is going to be some benefit for them, but they're also going to be able to realise that benefit and take it forward. And that's where I thought this opportunity for business, industry and government was for mathematical research. Because a lot of mathematical research, by mathematical I mean mathematical science research, is basically only written for, or the vehicles for it are only, particularly pure mathematics and applied mathematics, only for research that's academic. They're not publishing research that's academic to business, industry, or government. So, having spotted this possible opportunity, we had to decide whether or not we could actually add any value to it through our usual skills. And, oops, that's wrong. I've got the wrong slide here. Never mind, never mind. Our usual skills are, in fact, as I said, development and presentation, but they're also about curation. We have to make sure that stuff is discoverable, we have to make sure that it's findable. Now, we know that there is a supply of mathematics and industry research because about 50 years ago, a group started in Oxford called Maths in Industry. It started small, it gradually grew, it's now a global phenomenon. It's not actually that well known, I would say, outside of its adherence. But I think that's partly due to the fact that it was, it didn't really have a vehicle. A lot of research, even if it's valuable, was just being left in reports that stayed on shelves. I spoke to somebody once in a northern university who'd been approached by a small business, a local business. They had a problem. It needed a mathematician to solve it. They didn't employ a mathematician. They came to this guy who, with a team of postdocs and what have you, and solved their problem. They actually saved a small company, very small company, £6 million in just 1 year. That's got real value. How can you take that content, that idea, and transmit it in a way that doesn't compromise the company's IP, doesn't put them at a doesn't give their competitors an advantage, but makes sure that there's a pre-competitive element to the story that will get out into the world. It will benefit the reader, it will benefit the mathematician, it will certainly benefit the early career researcher, and because they'll get their name on a piece of content that somehow, even if it's informally published in a journal, it is informally published in a way that that can be cited, that has DOIs, that has metadata, that has, you know, that's fully searchable, Google can crawl over it, all the rest of it. And that's why we start, so we created a new type of vehicle, which we called NIR. It's nothing to do with the old Russian publishing, but it stands, I think, I should know this, Maths in Industry Report. There's a missing eye, but I can't remember what that is. Boom! Okay. And, you know, we started this just under a year ago. We launched it with some funds from the European Consortium of Mathematics and Industry. We made a few historic reports available. I think about 60 historical reports. 60 historical reports that we deem have continuing value. We have it moderated. It's not like the archive. It's got metadata and DOIs, unlike the archive. It's been bought into by other study groups worldwide. As I said, we launched with about 60 or 70 historic papers. We're adding to it now. We've got analytics. We know that there's been about 50,000 downloads and views. We think that's quite a good number for historic content. We don't know if the ultimate user, which is industry, business, or government, is going to benefit. We hope so. It's getting cited. Papers are getting cited which they weren't before. So we think there's something in there, and we'd like to grow that. We've got plans to grow it. We know that the Maths and Industry Study Group have already, I won't say spawned, but they're being joined by things like knowledge exchange, and Chris might talk about that a little bit, and we're going to be aiming to add knowledge exchange content as well to it. So I think the opportunity and the role of the publisher here has been to bring their traditional skills of curation, development, presentation, this and the other, to a new, apply those in a but in a new way. We see some new opportunities. We can still do that there. And ultimately, that we have to do that in a business way, because even if we're not for profit and all the rest of it, we still have to be a business. We're not being funded by anybody. We have to make sure that the people who are publishing will pay for what we've got. So, is that lesson finished? Okay.